Thank you. Now we move on to very important topic of COVID kidney. When the Abraham was a savior for the Israelites, this Dr. Georgi Abraham is a crusader against the COVID disease. He's a legendary personality in treating kidney disease and kidney failure. He's the founder trustee of a Tanker Foundation. He has got a lot of innumerable, awards and titles in his name. He's a professor of medicine, Pondicherry Institute of Medical Science, Director of Nephrology, Madras Medical Mission, Chennai, Adjunct Professor of Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, an International Advisor of Royal College of Physicians, London, Kumar and Clark Clinical Medicine, a Coordinator, Host Examiner of MRCP PACES in South Asia, Executive Member of SARC Nephrology, Urology and Transplantation, and a Founder Trustee of K.V. George Foundation, Kerala Kidney Foundation, Tanker Foundation. As you all know well that many of the people in Tamil Nadu and even in India are weeping from the kidney disease. They are going to regularly for the dialysis with the weeping eye, with the bleeding souls. For those souls and weeping eye, he is the savior and crusader for all those sufferings. A founder president of Peritoneal Dialysis Society of India, and editor-in-chief Indian Journal of Peritoneal Dialysis, South Asian Journal of Peritoneal Dialysis, Urology and Transplantation. Now I welcome Professor George Abraham to talk on the COVID kidney. Over to you, sir.
At the outset, I want to thank Dr. Subramaniam, president of my Kodambakkam. And also Dr. Bhupati and the Dr. Sai, Professor Sai, who has given me this opportunity to speak to you on COVID.
Unmute, unmute, Panama.
So let me move on. Thanks.
Can you mute all?
I want to pay my homage and tribute to Professor. Can you see me? Can you see the slides?
Yes, I can see.
Can you see the slides? Hello?
Slides are visible. Please go ahead, sir.
Can you see?
I think he has dropped out. His internet connection must be unstable. We have to wait for him to log in again.
Sir, can you mute all others other than the speaker?
Sir, that is not possible. I can either mute everybody or unmute everybody. So such a function is not available. So individual persons must be able to not unmute themselves.
Yeah, he's come, sir. Subramani, sir.
Vandutara?
Yeah, vandutara. George Abraham, you can unmute him.
His internet connection must be joining. So let him come in, I will guide him.
Yeah, yeah, now he has come. Now we're able to see his face in the screen.
Usually audio takes a little more time to join.
Okay, no issues, no issues. You can wait.
Okay, Dr. George Abraham.
Can I start now?
Yes, sir. Please start, sir.
Okay. Let me start. At the outset, I want to thank Dr. Subramaniam, president of IMA Kodambakkam, Dr. Bhupati, and also Professor Sangwa's invitation to speak on COVID and the kidney. So I want to pay my tribute to my great friend who is no more with us, Professor S. Chandrasekhar. And he was my colleague at Sri Ramachandra Medical College from 1996 onwards, and he was quite a humane person, simplicity, honesty, and transparency, and always there to help the poor as well as to help the medical students. There are so many instances when we had humor during the MBBS examination when both of us were competing each other to pass the students in their MBBS examination, because they all deserve, and some of the external examinations stood little against it. And also, I want to pay my tribute to one of the doctors who was my student who passed away 2 days ago. It is Dr. Prasad from Theni, and he used to be our student, both Chandrasekhar and mine, in 2000. And I want to pay my tribute to him. This is a very challenging time for all of us. The COVID is taking a toll on us, and it is brutal. And we have to find how to take care of our patients. There are many of our healthcare colleagues who have succumbed to COVID across the country and internationally. And I just want to reiterate what Mr. Ratan Tata has said about a couple of months ago. If you are alive this year, that is your wealth. Many of us are enough in the four and a half months we are alive and doing very doing our duties to our patients. So I pay my tribute again to an excellent human being, and let me start my talk. I will dwell on what is the COVID situation in our country, and also regarding the COVID and the kidney, and also COVID situation in other countries, and also what are the challenges faced by people who have come out of COVID and how to rehabilitate them.
Yeah. You will find share screen at the bottom. It's a green button. Once you click the share screen, you must be able to see the PowerPoint and click the PowerPoint. Then you click the done button, which is usually a blue button.
Yeah. Our COVID-19.
Sorry, sir, we are not.
Medical mission where I was,
sir, your screen is not yet shared.
Sorry, I'll just.
If your screen is on full screen view, if you can hit the escape button, you can see all the buttons there. Hit the escape button, make the window a little smaller. Then you can see share screen at the bottom. Click the share screen. It's a green button. Then you will see the number of, yes, now you have started screen sharing. But you have to choose the PowerPoint presentation. Is your PowerPoint already open? Yes, I can see your PowerPoint, sir. Now please go to slideshow. Slideshow is at the bottom right, next to the slider.
Yeah. Can you see it now? Can you see the slide?
It is only one slide.
Can you see the slide?
I can see the slide, but this is only one slide.
Yes, one slide you can see.
This one slide I can see, sir. It says kidney disease associated with in-hospital death of patients with COVID-19.
No, not that.
Not that, right? Because this is only one slide in the PowerPoint.
No.
You have to close this PowerPoint separately, open the correct PowerPoint, and then share that screen. COVID kidney, 26-7. Yes, sir, the correct one came up. So please do it all over again. Share screen. Then you have to click the COVID-19 PowerPoint presentation. I'm able to see your desktop, sir.
Yeah. Just fine.
First, you open the COVID kidney presentation, and then we can go ahead with the screen share.
Yeah, it's open now. Can you see? Can you see?
No, sir. Your file explorer is open. You have not chosen the correct file to be shared.
Yeah.
I would suggest you stop the screen share, go out, close all the unnecessary files, and open only the PowerPoint presentation. Are you able to get it?
Yes, pressing on. Yeah.
No, this is a browser window. I am able to see Zoom here. Okay. I would suggest you close all the unnecessary ones. Just open only the PowerPoint presentation. Yes, COVID kidney has come now. Please show slideshow, please. Yes, correct button. Please press that, sir. Yes, sir. Now you are on, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
You can see now?
Yes, sir. I see Dr. Chandrasekhar's picture and then your second slide now.
Right. So our experience of COVID-19, we had 152 patients on maintenance hemodialysis at Madras Medical Mission Hospital. And initially, five of them got infected. They were diabetic. They were elderly. And one older gentleman who was above 80 years passed away. Our strategy differed after that, because there was a presentation of using colchicine 0.5 milligram three times a week after dialysis. This was presented by Dr. Lloyd Vincent internationally. And I have put all my patients on colchicine 0.5 milligram three times a week after dialysis. Those who are on twice a week, they take it another extra day. And we haven't had any further COVID infections either in the Madras Medical Mission Hospital or in the Tanger Foundation, where we have 571 patients on dialysis. Among them, 21 got infected and two of them died. So all these patients are taking for a minimum period of 4 weeks, colchicine tablet, 0.5 milligram, three times a week after dialysis. And one patient we started on peritoneal dialysis who had CKD, who was COVID positive, and she recovered. And she developed one special complication, that is egg calculus pancreatitis. This is reported, but not in a peritoneal dialysis patient. Luckily, the peritoneal dialysis went on well, and their serum amylase levels and lipase levels went above 1,000, and it slowly came down, and she became COVID negative. And we checked the dialysis effluent fluid for the presence of COVID antigen, and it was found to be negative. So we had three of our kidney transplant patients who had COVID, and there were two women and one man, and they all recovered with minor symptoms. And we also had a heart transplant patient at the Madras Medical Mission Hospital who had COVID and who recovered and left yesterday. So this is our history of COVID. So let me take you to the next slide. So this is the case of a gentleman who is a 71-year-old male, type 2 diabetes mellitus for many years, CKD stage 3A. 3A is glomerular filtration rate is between 14 to 59 ml per minute. So he had a bipolar disorder and he was taking, he's a businessman, taking drugs for that. He was unwell for a week, and then I got a call that his saturation was falling, his sugars were going up, and immediately I pushed him to do a CT scan. And this is a CT chest which was reported as COVID-19 pneumonia. And the saturation was falling, and he was admitted in the COVID ward, and he was taken care with the intravenous methylprednisolone and antibiotic therapy. And this is the second CT which is shown on 2-7. This was on 27-6-2-7. And this is 2 days prior to his discharge. 3 days prior to his discharge, this shows almost complete clearance of his lung with the saturation at room air being above 97. So he was tested for antibodies. His antibody levels were, IgG antibody levels were 130. Not only that, he had also kidney disease. I mentioned already, The serum creatinine went up to 4.7 milligram. What is this 4.7 milligram? This is stage 3 AKI, acute kidney injury in stage 3. Stage 3 is whenever the serum creatinine goes 3 times above baseline, it is called as stage 3 kidney. So the serum creatinine also, it did not require any dialysis, and the serum creatinine came down to 1.87 milligram at the time of discharge. His hemoglobin A1C at the time of admission was 8.9. Urine PCR, protein creatinine ratio, was 0.27. His urine had WBC 3 to 5, now on discharge. So this tells you that appropriate care, even in a diabetic with chronic kidney disease, could result in resolution of the lung lesion, and also an acute kidney injury can be managed in a unit with appropriate institution of fluid electrolyte therapy. And this is a typical example. And I am told by Dr. Gopalakrishnan at the GH, head of the Department of Nephrology, that they have treated about 160 patients with chronic kidney disease on dialysis. So this case highlights that not necessary that all patients with lung disease and kidney injury would succumb to that, and they can recover. And however, one should be careful, because he had a hit of acute kidney injury, 4.7, and one should be careful to follow him up, because it is possible that he may go into chronic kidney disease and worsening of chronic kidney disease, and this may should be followed up regularly with a serum creatinine and a urine examination, blood pressure, and also with diabetic control. So sorry about this busy slide. COVID-19 comorbidities of dialysis patients and impact on, there is a threefold increase in COVID in patients with CKD. At every stage of CKD, the patients have a threefold increase, and patients on dialysis have the most frequent and the most intimate contact with the hospital staff. They are hemodialysis patients, so it is easy to spread in hemodialysis patients. Additionally, these patients can't abide by the standard instructions to avoid infection, are unable to just shelter in a place. COVID is highly complicated and the first cause of death in patients. The heart disease is one of the most common cause present in over 50% of patients. Diabetes is the leading cause of kidney disease present in 40% of the patients. And hypertension is the second most common cause of kidney disease present in 25% of the patients. So older adults and people are a heightened risk of COVID kidney. Patients on dialysis are older and have underlying medical conditions. Patients with heart or lung disease or diabetes seem to be at higher risk for developing more serious complications. And the management of patients with kidney disease even more challenging because use of immunosuppression and or comorbidity. In India, we are blessed that our mortality rate is quite low. And I have shown in my data from our center, and none of our patients succumb transplant patients, whereas in other centers across the country, there are a number of transplant patients who were dying and dialysis units were closed down because the staff were scared to come to the dialysis unit. And this also happened in Chennai. But luckily, we were able to open and operate all our tanker dialysis units. And during COVID, we opened two dialysis units under Tanker and Corporation of Madras at Injambakkam and Valsaravakkam. So kidney disease associated with hospital death of patient with COVID. This is patient selection, kidney disease, association of kidney disease and in hospital death. The confirmed COVID-19 above 18, no maintenance dialysis, no renal transplantation. There were 701 patients. The mean age was 63, 52 were male, 42 had severe COVID and 42 had comorbidity, and 61 patients are in hospital death. Prevalence of kidney abnormalities, the prevalence is shown there, elevated serum creatinine, as I have shown in my patient, elevated blood urea and nitrogen, eGFR less than 60 ml per minute, that is stage 3, proteinuria in 43%, hematuria in 26%, and acute kidney injury in 5.1%. So acute kidney injury develops only in critically ill patients who are on ventilator or who are very sick. So association of kidney disease and in-hospital death, this is from Wuhan in 2020, where the COVID was diagnosed initially. And you can see that depending upon the hematuria and or proteinuria and stage 3 kidney disease, they had the confidence interval, they had more deaths in stage 3 kidney disease. So this shows you that various kidney ailments, including abnormalities only in the urine and decreased EFR and AKI stage 3 could lead to more morbidity and mortality. So clinicians should increase their awareness of kidney disease in patients with COVID. So this this is just to jog your memory. There were 26 autopsies done in 19 patients, death due to respiratory failure. Average age was 69 years, 19 were males, 7 were females. 9 showed clinical signs of kidney injury like elevated creatinine, abnormal urine sediment, decreased urine output. So this is a kidney biopsy which shows RBC aggregates in peritubular capillary. Just to simplify things, this is a glomerulus which looks full. This is a tubule, and you can see that RBC aggregates are shown by the shadow in the peritubular. This is a tubular peritubular capillaries. And also the patient has developed acute tubular necrosis. You can see the casts in the tubules and showing that the patient has acute tubular injury. And see, there are a lot of debates on whether the COVID virus is seen in the kidney or not. There are some who say that it is seen, others say it is not. So what are the causes of AKI in COVID? It is ATN, acute tubular necrosis due to rhabdomyolysis, interstitial kidney disease, podocytopathy giving rise to proteinuria, microangiopathy giving rise to, because the small blood vessels in the kidney are damaged with clots, and collapsing glomerulonephropathy. So current understanding and optimal disease management of COVID-19 based on Brescia COVID renal risk disease, Italian experience, their dedicated COVID unit and renal task force, hemodialysis number 21, this is all the data which is coming out, transplant 20, CKD or AKI or 5, number 46. In the first phase, pharmacological approaches as a two-phase approach. First phase, viral replication and cytopathic effect. We know that they attach to the ACE2 receptors, and we have all been using these drugs without any direction. And then the second phase, came out with remdesivir, azithromycin, corticosteroid, and tocilizumab for decreasing the cytokine storm. And this begins 7 to 10 days after the onset of symptoms, as shown here. Clinical patient management, chest X-ray at baseline, repeat when respiratory deterioration is noted. But I would suggest that in some of the patients, chest X-ray is not helpful, and we have to resort to CT. I have shown, and they may also have hemophagocytic syndrome, and glucocorticoids and the tocilizumab are the drugs of choice when there is cytokine storm with severe lung injury, and repeat ABGs, ferritin level, all inflammatory markers including ferritin, D-dimer and CRP are elevated, and liver enzyme elevation. So these protocols are based on in vitro and in viral effects and empirical observations of other countries. Conclusion: the optimal management of COVID-19 infected patients is still unclear, although the consensus is moving towards the need of biphasic approach. So CKD5 patients on dialysis are a vulnerable group. They are in a room together for about 4 to 5 hours, staff intensive area, skilled staff pushed to attend many patients in a session, no need to travel from community 2 to 3 times a week from different areas as we have seen, multiple comorbidities, they are immunocompromised, there is overlapping symptoms, some may have fever, some may have only cough, some may complain of body ache, some may have PR patients who have diarrhea and vomiting. So COVID testing is not practical in all of them, a limited option of postponing session, because even in America, they have the richest country and the large number of dialysis patients, they have suggested that some of the patients can be, their dialysis can be tailored down to twice a week instead of 3 times a week with appropriate fluid balance and restrict salt intake and control the electrolyte imbalance by the food intake. Danger of unit and health staff being affected and shut down. In our Tanger dialysis unit, 8 of our staff got infected and they all recovered without any major issues. And seven of them left, and we had to recruit new staff to run the dialysis unit. So how to retain staff is a major issue when you have COVID. And at the Madras Medical Mission Hospital, we had one staff. He was a dialysis head who became COVID positive. I think he got it from the community. However, we took care of him, and now he is negative and he has come back. Now, what are the advantages of home peritoneal dialysis? You don't have to do hemodialysis. You don't have to travel to the center. You are not in contact with patients. You are not in contact with the staff. You are not in contact with anybody. Thoughtfully arranged transport during lockdown, the supplies can be given to the patient at home. Insisted hospitals not to deny or refer out hemodialysis patients, because even in America, there was a trend, and in UK during the COVID time, to put patients on peritoneal dialysis. And I will show you what we did. There are patients from ESRD zones, hence, you know, they are scared about coming to the hospital. So home peritoneal dialysis will be an ideal choice. Testing issues are there for COVID. Threat of closing down and quarantining of hemodialysis unit. So I will just skip. This talks about the advantages of PD, travel, contact, cluster, medical resources, workforce, hemodynamic stability, respiratory symptoms, special considerations. So considering all these, PD has many advantages. Home peritoneal dialysis has many advantages compared to hemodialysis in patients with COVID. So this is our facility, one of our nurses, you know, she is training a patient. This is not a COVID patient for peritoneal dialysis at home. His brother is going to help him with the dialysis. So CAPD is a plausible alternative. Reality is that we will have to live with COVID for such future viruses for a long time. It is not going to leave us for probably for months or years. An afterthought, we and government would have been better if PD has been chosen over hemodialysis. The Prime Minister's PMJAY has introduced PD on our request for the common citizens of the country. So it is time that we encourage patients to go on home peritoneal dialysis to reduce the spread and to reduce the morbidity in patients with chronic kidney disease. So the Royal College of Physicians sent this data on UK. There are 20,000 patients on hemodialysis in the UK. This was in April. And in the past 2 weeks, 926 patients have contracted COVID-19 with a mortality rate of 15%. And so patients on hemodialysis with COVID-19, they have less lymphopenia, lower serum levels of inflammatory cytokines, and milder clinical disease than other patients with COVID-19 infection. Men and women of Black or South Asian ethnicity have a higher rate of infection compared to those of white ethnicity. So Mumbai dialysis units, patients who tested positive for COVID-19, made to run from pillar to post. Dialysis wards are latest source of COVID spread because they stay there for hours together, and they are not separated in isolated cubicles. Even if they are in isolated cubicles, other patients may cough, they may sneeze, they may talk. So their droplet infection is high in hemodialysis units. So the COVID, and this is Lombardy data from Italy. So the staff COVID positive 84 in the hemodialysis unit, and staff COVID positive none in the peritoneal dialysis unit. So this highlights the importance of peritoneal dialysis. Hemodialysis patients COVID were 8%, whereas peritoneal dialysis patients who contracted COVID was only 1%. So this highlights the fact that peritoneal dialysis is a superior mode of therapy to prevent the spread of COVID and for the well-being of the patient. Sorry about this busy slide. Guidelines for dialysis issued by the Government of India, administration, dialysis process, hemodialysis units, patients, acute kidney injury, what should be done. I didn't have any patients with acute kidney injury except the patient I showed, but I heard from Government Medical College and also CMC Vellore. They had a number of patients with acute kidney injury who succumbed with COVID. Then CRRT procedure, this is also done in the hospital where the chance of infection are high. The dialysis, the tubing is clogged because there is hypercoagulability, and they have seen the same complication in Western countries as well. So peritoneal dialysis, I said already the advantages, and protectivity, and protectivity of the equipment is also a very important thing when doing hemodialysis in patients with COVID. So, Brassica, I will skip that because we have already mentioned about that. So COVID-19, adding a few more pieces to the puzzle, review of the current papers, the clinical presentation, mortality rate in maintenance is not well established. We do not know much about it all over the world. Data from Spain, Italy, and UK suggest wide range of symptoms. Significant proportion of patients are asymptomatic. Prolonged positivity of pharyngeal swabs, high mortality, almost 30%. This is very high compared to UK, it was 15%. And so I would suggest that to dialysis facilities, if the patient is symptomatic and they have to be screened for COVID positive by doing the RT-PCR test. So COVID. So I will go to the other issues associated, trauma associated with the treatment, in-center trauma, confined to and connected with vexatious repeated intubation and reinsertion of the prolonged intubation, powerful sedative medications, paralyzing drugs to keep the reflexes from fighting the ventilator tube. Some must be physically restrained as they may harm themselves, delirium, being treated by unfamiliar paths. So patients have to be on prone ventilation. And there was a webinar which we did, even in prone ventilation, you can have a peritoneal dialysis catheter which can be implanted and the exit can be through the lateral part, and these patients can. Now, COVID-19 psychosomatic sequelae of the treatment, post-traumatic stress disorder, profound debilitation, weakness, memory loss, anxiety, depression, and hallucinations, difficulty in sleeping, walking, and talking, prospect of prolonged separation, unable to receive friends or loved ones, spouses or children may act as caregivers, emotional and physical challenges, feeling of frustration by their dependence on others, family caregivers may show signs of depression. So one of my patients, the peritoneal dialysis patient who recovered, she came back with, even though she is COVID negative, continuing peritoneal, some neurological symptoms, and we found that she has developed early Parkinsonism. Is it due to COVID or is it not related to COVID? It is very difficult to say at this point in time. And also another patient whom we had, the heart transplant patient, made a threat that she will jump from the hospital and commit suicide. So these are some of the psychosomatic sequelae of COVID which we have to take care of and to be aware of that. So rehabilitation after treatment, rehabilitation is support of psychologists, therapists, nutritionists, pharmacists and social workers, pulmonologists, rehab specialists, psychiatrists, dietitians and therapists, especially in patients with chronic kidney disease, physical therapy, occupational therapy, social interaction, case managers, functional planners, pulmonary rehabilitation and reducing oxygen support, building strength and endurance, breathing technique, including how to cough better, help them to recover their motor skill, and nutrition is support for their diet. This is a cartoon which is shown there on the left-hand side. So I would like to conclude by saying that COVID-19 healthcare would be reinvent itself while healthcare workers continue to fight. Five stages for healthcare institutions in the battle against COVID. This is resolved. We need to have the resolve. Unprecedented effort, most far-reaching. Then resilience, economics, impact of virus suppression in efforts could be the biggest nearly challenge. And then return back to normalcy. Then reimagine, that is restructuring of service delivery to match back preference and also expectations, use of technology for flexible and productive delivery, then reform, fundamental reshuffling of the relationship between stakeholders, helping to shape a better society to prevent a failure of health crisis. So we are all for you, the healthcare workers, and stay home and stay safe. Healthcare has found itself tested by the pandemic.
I think his connection has got cut again, sir.
Okay. Shall we wait for a few minutes, sir?
Let us wait for a few minutes for him to log in.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, my computer crashed and I logged on from my iPad.
Oh.
That is why I went missing.
Okay, okay.
I think the heat that so many video seminars, it's not able to take.
Yeah,
yeah. Old laptop.
President, he is back.
Okay. We'll give him a chance
to
conclude
yeah.
and take some questions.
Yeah, yeah.
And then subsequently, we can go to honoring.
Okay.
I have the honoring plaque also on my iPad.
Okay, no problem. I will hand over the session to you regarding the honoring.
Okay.
Now he has come.
So, any questions? Any questions? You have seen my last slide? Have you seen my last slide?
Last slide we haven't seen, sir.
Okay, this is
the last slide. You can give your concluding remarks and your last slide also.
Okay.
Then you can ask for questions and then we can proceed with the next one, sir.
So, the last slide is there are five stages for healthcare institutions in the battle against COVID. We need to have resilience and try to return back to normal, reimagine and reform. And so healthcare has found itself tested by the patient, frontliners are delivering heroically, but then the healthcare will look nothing like what it was before. So we have to have the resolve to fight COVID, and especially the patients who are on dialysis and who are on transplant and who are developing chronic kidney disease, to provide them the healthcare what they need, either through direct contact, because we are not making many direct contact, or through telemedicine, because the blood test results are available and the patients can tell their blood pressure if they have a BP above test, and we can do a lot of telemedicine to help these patients with chronic kidney disease. Holding hands together to save humanity from COVID-19. So we all have to work together. This is my concluding slide.
Thank you, sir. Dear members, any questions you can raise? You can ask questions to Dr. George Abraham. Yeah, Dr. Mani has come. Sir, you can unmute yourself, sir.
I can unmute.
Subramani sir, Mani unmute pannunga, Dr. Mani sir.
Inda vare.
1 minute. Wait, sir. Yeah. 1 minute.
அவர் தான் அன்மியூட் பண்ணிக்கணும் எனக்கு அன்மியூட் பண்ண வரல
சார் மணி சார்
கேன் யூ ஹியர் மீ சார்
யா 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 ஓகே யா யா
ஐ கேன் ஹியர் யூ
யூ கோ அஹெட்
சார் யூ டோல்ட் அபௌட் எ பிசினஸ்மேன் வித் பைபோலார் டிஸார்டர்
எஸ்
ஹட் எ கிட்னி ப்ராப்ளம் வாஸ் இட் லித்தியம் இன்ட்யூஸ்ட்
நோ ஹி வாஸ் ஆன் நோ 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 ஹிஸ் கிட்னி டிசீஸ் வி டு நாட் நோ நோபடி ஹஸ் டன் எ பயோப்சி ஹி வாஸ் டேக்கிங் அட் லீஸ்ட் அபௌட் 4 ட்ரக்ஸ் ஹி இஸ் நாட் மை பேஷண்ட் பட் ஹி வாஸ் எ ரிலேட்டிவ் ஆஃப் மைன் ஐ ஹட் டு ஸ்டெப் இன் டு சேவ் ஹிஸ் லைஃப் And he was taking kashayam, he was taking that. This, you just imagine, you know, the number of medications he was taking for his diabetes, for his bipolar, as well as, you know, the herbal things. So this is something, you know, I just want to highlight.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any questions from our members? Okay, sir. Sir, thank you for your exhaustive lecture.